going to do the prayer for the prayer box within the confines of the lesson today. We have a scripture that will really tie in with that very well. I know I have asked some of you if you would like to pray, and I've had a very little response. So, last week, remember, we had some scriptures about the thorn and putting up the hedge of thorns, etc. And today I'm going to use another scripture. So I'm going to make this maybe a little easier for you. In your readings, if you come across a scripture that you think would be awesome for us to use with our prodigals in the prayer box, send me that scripture, okay? And then these are some things we can start praying, scriptures we can pray for the people in the prayer box, and then I'll make the slide and work them into the lesson. You are just furnishing scriptures that you come across that you think would be an awesome thing for us to use. So that's one way that you can help me. Some of you noticed that we put out a deal yesterday. Malin is trying to up the traffic to advertise the Bible study. And it's great that you do the like, but it helps us even more if you will share it on your timeline. So those of you that know what I'm talking about, if you would do that, we would appreciate it. So, everybody have a lesson? Don't faint. I know some of you have seen it's 9 pages, when sometimes I do 4. But what do we always find out? The lesson is about the same amount of time, no matter how many pages there are. So put on your seatbelt, because we have a lot to cover today. We are continuing our series, Seeking My King and His Kingdom. And we are coming to lesson number 15. And I have entitled this, The Mediatorial Kingdom in Old Testament History. Now, a couple of weeks ago, we learned about what the mediatorial kingdom is. Big word, which means God is establishing a kingdom on earth, and he uses a mediator. And that person will be between him and the people, between God and the people. He sets up a mediator. So that's what we're looking at, and we are going to do a brief history today of this mediatorial kingdom in the Old Testament. Now, we know that the very first mediatorial ruler was who? Moses. Because before he brought them out of Egypt, remember, it started with Abraham, and he called him to be the father of the nation that was going to be coming. And then we go down to Jacob. Jacob had the 12 sons, and at this point, they're the 12 sons. They become the 12 tribes of Israel. 70 of them, remember, are taken, and they go where? To Egypt. And during the time of Egypt, they are growing there, they are multiplying. God is really multiplying their numbers, and when they come out of Egypt, they will be close to 2 million people, counting the women and the children. They did very well in Egypt until Exodus chapter 1. And what happened? A Pharaoh arose that did not know Joseph. So then the oppression really came, and the people were under oppression. So after a period of years, God has been training Moses. He trains him, and then for a while he's on the backside of the desert taking care of sheep, learning to be a shepherd. So we have Moses, and he's going to use him to bring the children of Israel out of Egypt. Many of your commentators will call the Exodus, coming out of Egypt and crossing the Red Sea, this is the birth of the nation of Israel. And God is going to use Moses in order to have this birth take place. Now, what is their destination? If you see the little footprints across the screen, what is their destination? God has brought them out of Egypt. They've crossed the Red Sea. And God has a specific purpose for them now. And he has a goal in mind for them. He is taking them to where? Mount Sinai. This is also called God's mountain. So they're on their way, and they take some time, and God leads them to Mount Sinai. He has a goal for taking them there. Now, the climax of this birth is that the 12 tribes, they've just been basically 12 tribes, And now God is going to unite them inwardly and bring them and unite them as a people into a nation of Israel. Now the manifestation, when they get to Mount Sinai, they are going to see God's revelation of himself to them in a stupendous way. There's going to be all kinds of phenomena and majesty and grandeur that they have never seen before. God's really going to reveal himself to this people, so they will be in awe. This is the God that we love. This is a God that loves us, that has chosen us and called us out. Now, all this phenomena that's going to take place on Mount Sinai, it will be visible to every one of the people. He's going to show himself to everyone that's at Mount Sinai. And it's intended to reveal, what's God trying to do? I want you to see who the God is that brought you out of bondage. He's establishing you as a nation. I have raised up a leader for you that will be the mediator between me and between yourselves. They want him to see as sovereign God and develop that reverential awe and fear that all of us are to have for God. He says, I am the King eternal, and he's now going to establish his kingdom on earth among men. So we are going to look at this kingdom in history and learn some lessons that can be applied in our own lives. God came to Moses and he said, y'all have an appointment with me in 3 days. I'm coming on the third day. And he says, for 2 days, you tell the people, they consecrate themselves, they wash their clothes, and they get ready, not only physically, but spiritually, get ready to meet with Jehovah God. And so on day three, God's going to come down in the sight of all of these people. And it says in Exodus, on day three, we're at day three, it's morning time. And what begins to happen? They've been waiting. There's thunder, there's lightning flashes, a thick cloud envelops Mount Sinai. There's a very loud trumpet sound, and it gets louder and louder and louder, and the tempo increases, and the sound is faster and faster. And it's to all the people who were in the camp. What's their reaction? They're scared to death. They are trembling. I'm sure that we would have been also. And Moses brings the people into the camp to near God to meet him, and all these people are standing at the foot of the mountain. Here's an artist's rendition. I always like pictures to try to help me be there with them, put myself in their place, and see what it might have been like. We have a mountain that is on fire. It's thundering. There's all kinds of rumblings going on. The mountain is quaking. I'm hearing sounds that are increasing in intensity and in speed. It says in Exodus 24, it says that now the glory of the Lord, this is what they keep referring to as the glory of the Lord, the light and the cloud that has enveloped the mountain. It comes to Mount Sinai, and it's going to rest on it for 6 days. And we're just wondering, what's going to happen next? 6 days, nothing. And then on the seventh day, it says God calls to Moses out of this cloud. And in Exodus 24:17, it says, the sight of the glory of the Lord was like what? A devouring fire. Can you think maybe of like a volcano that's erupting, and the fire and the smoke that is coming out of the mount? And we have another artist rendition of what that might have looked like. And the people, remember, they waited 6 days and there was nothing. And then on the seventh day, this began to happen. So now God is ready for them, and he's going to have their covenant. He's coming to them. He has given them all kinds of stupendous signs. He wants them to see that he is a God worthy of worship, that he is sovereign. So he's going to establish his covenant with them now. And in chapter 19, verse 4, here's how God starts. You have seen for yourself how I carried you on the wings of eagles, and I brought you to myself. God's the one that took them out of bondage out of Egypt, and he has brought them here for himself. And he says, therefore, what's my next word? If. Our favorite word, right? If. So there's some parameters. I've brought you here. Now, if you will what? I want you to obey my voice, and I want you to keep my commandments. Two things. Keep the covenant, the commandments, and obey my voice. He says, then what will happen? You will be my treasured possession. You will be the people that I favor upon all of the earth, above all other peoples. Then he says, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests, and you're going to be a holy nation. Does that sound very familiar with what the church is told in the New Testament? The kingdom of priests and the holy nation, and we are to be the bride of Christ. This is Jehovah God talking to the nation of Israel at this time. Now, a side note for some of you that like these kind of things, this is the first time the kingdom is mentioned in the Bible. So this is a first occurrence, and those usually are significant. And notice that from now on, the kingdom is going to be associated with God ruling. We will see that all throughout. And notice it is a kingdom unto. That's a very important word. It's not just the kingdom of God. He's the one establishing it. But when he makes the kingdom is supposed to be unto him. So we want to make that discrepancy in the definition. Now, the kingdom is going to be given to one nation at this time, and it's going to be given to the nation of Israel. And God is going to lift them up into an exalted position. And this kingdom has a definite beginning, and I believe this kingdom starts at the foot of Mount Sinai. He has been working with them, bringing them there, but now he's going to make the covenant and actually set up the kingdom. Now, he said, I want you to be a kingdom of priests. What did the priests do? They were the mediators between God and the people, right? And Israel is supposed to be that for all the other nations around them. They're supposed to be the ones that are led by God, directed by God. They're obeying his covenants. And they are to point all the other nations to him and show them the light. And he said, you're to be a holy nation. You are my possession. Does that not remind us of the scripture in New Testament that says after we're born again, we are not our own, right? We have been bought with a price. We are God's possession. And he told Israel the same thing, and I want you to be morally pure. So this condition, this covenant that he's going to establish at Mount Sinai, do you see that it's conditional? I heard the word if. If you will do these two things, I will do all of this. So there's obedience involved. Last week with the covenant with Abraham, we saw it was unconditional. Remember, he put Abraham to sleep, and God did the walking between the animals, the sacrifice, and Abraham did nothing. But that was an unconditional covenant. So he says, if you will obey my voice, and if you will keep my commands, he said, you'll be the treasured people on the face of the earth. You'll be a kingdom of holy, of priests, and a holy nation. So the people are standing there, and we have an idea of what's been going on now. And what do the people say? We will. We will. We're all in. And they said, all the people answered together. It was unanimous. And they said, everything that Jehovah or Yahweh has spoken, we will do it. And Moses went back to God. Remember, he's the mediator. He went back to God and told them they are ready to do everything. Now, we're going to fast forward. We are going from mediatorial rulers now, beginning with Moses, and we are going clear to Saul in just a few minutes. Okay? This is going to be quick. Now, after Moses goes off the scene, who is God's next mediator? Joshua. And in Joshua 1:5, God gives Joshua the divine charge. He said, there shall not any man be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Isn't that an awesome promise? And he says, as I was with Moses, I'm going to be with you. I will not fail you, and I will not forsake you. Now, after Joshua dies, then who does God use to be the mediator? Judges. And the judges are chosen directly by God. And in Judges 2:16, it says, God himself now raises up judges who will deliver them out of those who were plundering them. Now, after the judges, And there's a cycle there, and we have talked about that cycle in past lessons. But when he's done with the judges, Samuel is the last one. And now he's going to choose a different type mediator person. And from Samuel, he is the link. He's the last judge, and he's setting up the first what? King. And so Samuel is told to anoint King Saul, and he's the first one. And now we're looking at a monarchical type form of government, because God's using a king to rule over the people. But he's still supposed to rule under God's direction. He's just the mediator. Now, this has been God's plan from Genesis with Abraham, because in Genesis 17:6, what did God say? I'm going to make you exceedingly fruitful. This was to Abraham. And I'm going to make nations of you. And what's coming from you? Kings. So he meant to have kings. That was in the original plan. Now, in Deuteronomy, God gives some instructions for the kings, and these were very significant. In Deuteronomy 17, he says God has rules. When a person comes to be your king, it has to be one that God has chosen, and he needs to be an Israelite. He needs to be from your family. And then he gives some instructions. The first thing he says, the king must not gather a great number of horses. Now, that's kind of a strange thing for the king, is it not? But what did God say? You're not to put your trust in anything else. If they had horses and chariots and so forth, they would have put their trust for their strength to win battles in that. God said none of that. And then he said, you shall not have many wives, because they will lead your heart astray from me. And then he said, you are not to accumulate large amounts of gold, silver, or wealth. And the last thing the kings were instructed to do, when the person that becomes a king, they're going to become a king, what are they supposed to be doing? Has God determined and purposed that you and I are to become a king in his kingdom? That's what the word says. So he said, when the person that is going to become a king, here's what they're to do. They are to take the scroll, all of God's law, and they are to write it and copy it for themselves on a scroll. So we see our little king sitting here, and it says, it shall be with him. He's going to read this all the days of his life, that he'll learn to fear the Lord his God by carefully observing all the words of God's law and its statutes. This is what the king was supposed to be doing. It says that his heart will not be lifted up his brother, and that he will not turn aside from the commandment to the right or to the left. He stays on that straight path, that he may prolong his days in his kingdom. Now, so the result of this, we see that the king would be God's chosen man. He would sit on an earthly throne in God's kingdom, and God's book was to constantly be before his eyes and in his heart. That's what the king was supposed to represent to the people. Now, the establishment, just because God was putting a king over the people of Israel, it did not end that it was God's theocratic rule. Who ultimately is ruling? God himself is ultimately ruling. So it didn't end that rule of him at all. In 1 Chronicles 17:14, God said, I will settle him, and he was talking about Solomon, in my house. And he said, he will be in my kingdom for how long? Forever. Now we want to fast forward past all of this, and we're going to start seeing the decline of the kingdom. This mediatorial kingdom is now going to be on a slippery slope, and we're going to have a downhill slide. What happened with King Solomon? He's the last of the three kings, and he openly violated the first three instructions that God gave. Because what did he do? He gathered all kinds of horses and equipment. He had many, like what, over 700 wives, and they did lead him astray. And he also accumulated lots of gold and silver. So he violated three of the instructions. Now, along with all this great worldly power and this wealth that Solomon was amassing, what's happening to the people? Moral deterioration is happening all over the nation, and they're going into apostasy. They're turning their backs on what they once believed, and they are apostatizing away from the God of Israel. Then we have what? A rupture in the kingdom. And after Solomon dies, you have Jeroboam becoming king of the 10 northern tribes, and Rehoboam is going to take the 2 southern tribes, Judah and Benjamin. Solomon dies, and things really, we come into a civil war, and the nation splits in two, and that rupture still stands. That has never been healed. It will be in the millennium. Now, during the decline, who now comes? Our Old Testament is filled with many prophets, right? We have the major prophets, we have the minor prophets. And now during this time, as Solomon has died and we're in the northern and the southern kingdom, prophets are really going to increase. Their words are going to increase, not just spoken words, but they're going to be writing them down during the period of the decline. So as the humans, the culture is just declining, declining, declining in the kingdom, what's happening with all the divine prophecy? It is increasing. So we have an inverse ratio. As the people are getting worse, what does God do? He sends his prophets more and more in increasing numbers with messages for the people from him. So we want to look at the ministry of the prophets. This is where we're going to camp for a little bit, because the ministry that they gave to the people who were in a moral and spiritual decline, can we apply those to us? Yes, and our purpose to study is never just to gain information. It's to take that information and let the Holy Spirit apply it to us in our lives. So we want to look at some of the prophets. So we are going to the doctor because our society has an illness, true? We can say that about ours today. Individuals have spiritual sickness, true? We have many of them that are here in our box that are spiritually have a problem because they have turned their back on what they once believed. So we are going to use the prophets to give us clues as to why we have such a sick culture, and we have even many believers that are actually spiritually sick. Now, we start with Isaiah. He was the first main prophet on the scene. And in Isaiah chapter 1, he starts out, verse 3, "The ox knows its master, the donkey knows its owner's manger, but Israel does not know." They don't know who their God is. They don't know who their owner is. They don't know where their sustenance comes from, and they do not understand. "Alas," he says, "we have a very sinful nation. We have a sinful people that are laden and they are just burdened down with iniquity in their lives. We have a brood of evildoers and their children are corruptors." This was the nation, the state of the nation back then. Could we not even say the same thing? We absolutely can. He said, "They have forsaken the Lord." As a country, we have done that. As a country, we have, and many societies around the world have. And it says, "We have provoked him to anger, the very Holy One of Israel." Now, I love this slide that somebody created. I don't know who did it, but it shows the nation as a whole. What are they doing? They are turning away backwards. God's reaching out to them. He's trying to stir them. He's trying to bring conviction in their lives. And what are people doing? Turn their back and not pay any attention. They're just walking away from it. Now, he says, "Why should you be stricken again?" Had God been sending chastisement upon him? He said, "Why should I keep doing it? Is it going to make any difference?" He said, "No." He said, "Because you'll just revolt more and more." The more punishment God sent upon them, it wasn't changing their heart. They were revolting even more. So, why are you doing this? He says, "Your whole head is sick." He said, "Your whole head is sick." He says, "Your heart is fainting." And he said, "From the sole of your foot, even clear to your head, there's no soundness in it." That is a pretty sick body, isn't it? And he says, you have wounds, you have all kinds of bruises, and you have putrefying sores, and they have never been closed up, they haven't been bound up, and you haven't allowed any ointment to come in and start healing them. Nothing. So we know that they have moral sickness, and that's what the doctor would tell them when they're trying to figure out the sickness of the society. Another clue is, your culture is like this, or you're in this state because you have moral sickness. He says in Isaiah, he says, woe to those who are calling evil good. That's where we are, isn't it? And he says, those who call evil good and they call good evil, and they put darkness for light and light for darkness. This is a quote I found from George Orwell, which I thought was really applicable. He says, the further a society drifts from the truth, the more that society will hate those that actually speak the truth. And we see that today, do we not? So we're still in the doctor's office. We're trying to find clues about our sick society. And he says, you have social and you have economic sickness also. In Amos chapter 8, he says, hear this, you people that are swallowing up the needy, and you make the poor of the land fail. You're not out helping them. You're causing them to fail even more. And then in Amos 8, he says, here's what the people in society were doing. When is that new moon going to be passed? Because we want to sell our grain. When is the Sabbath going to be over? Because we want to trade our wheat. And we make the ephah small and the shekel large. They falsified the scales, remember? They were doing everything they could in making life harder and harder on the poor of the land. And they even said, we want to buy the poor for some silver. They wanted to make slaves out of them, not help them. And they said, we want to buy the needy for a pair of sandals. And then they said, we want to even sell our bad wheat to them. That was the culture that they were living in. So the prophets began to give more clues. They said, you have degeneration among your rulers. It has crept up to the top level, and your rulers are corrupt. In Isaiah, he says, your princes are rebellious. They are companions of thieves. And he says, they love a bribe, and they're running after gifts. They do not defend the orphan. And they don't defend the widow's cause. It doesn't even come before their eyes. He says, you have evil among your spiritual leaders. It's not just the leaders out in society and the culture. It's even among the spiritual leaders, there was all kinds of evil and corruption. In Isaiah 28, he said this about the spiritual leaders. They reel with wine and they're staggering with strong drink. The priest and the prophet were staggering with strong drink. They're swallowed up by wine. They stagger with strong drink. They reel in their visions, and they stumble in giving judgment. Now, that's not much of a spiritual leader, is it, that we look to for guidance and instruction and example? And then he goes on in Ezekiel 34, and he says, son of man, I want you to prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Are they the ones that are supposed to be taking care of the people and leading them? He says, woe to the shepherds of Israel because they're only taking care of themselves. And he goes on to say, should not shepherds be taking care of their flock? You eat the curds, you're clothing yourself with the wool, and you're slaughtering the choice animals, but you won't take care of the flock. You have not strengthened the weak, or healed the sick, or bound up the injured. You have not brought back any of the strays. They're not out seeking the strays. They're not out seeking the lost. You have ruled them harshly and brutally. Those were the spiritual leaders in that day. So here's the prophet's advice. They said, here's what you need to do. We need you to get back to your original covenant. For that, you and me, that would be getting back to the Word of God, getting back to the truth and the basics and the tenets of our faith. This was Amos who came along, who was called the shepherd prophet. And Amos was called a man of the ancient ways. And he said, you need to restore the old theocratic ideal. In other words, you need to go back to how it used to be. Go back to like the covenant at Mount Sinai, where they said, we will, and we do, and we will obey. Now, Amos was an unusual prophet. His ethical protest when he's out prophesying to the people and preaching at them, it was drawn from a well that was 500 years deep. We've been 500 years since Mount Sinai at this point, and he's still trying to get them to return to the tenets of the faith and the Word of God and his commands. Isaiah, this was a very interesting passage in Isaiah 8. What does he say? To the law. Get back to the law. That's what you need to do, which in our case would be the Word of God. And get back to the testimony. And if people aren't speaking according to this word, they don't have any light in them. None. And that's what you and I, we need to really take this scripture to heart. Now, I want us to look at Jeremiah 6:16. I want you to flag it. This is the scripture you're going to pray for the prodigals in the box this week. I think it would be good if we have a different scripture every week and all of us unite together here and at home and continue to pray scripture over these prodigals. So this is the one I chose for today. This is the prophet Jeremiah. He says, thus says the Lord God. Here's his advice to those that have strayed. They've turned their back on God and they're not following him. Stand in the way. So they're going to stand. They come to a crossroads. Many of these people in the box have been at a crossroads, true? And they have to make a choice of what they're going to follow. So they're standing at a crossroads, and he said, see or look, and then ask, where are the old paths to get back to the ways of God, to get back to what the tenets of the faith and the doctrines of the faith. Ask for those old paths where the good way is. And then what are you supposed to do when you ask and you're told? Walk in it. Walk in it. So as I looked at this and put the little footprints on the path, can you see them? This would be my prayer that all these prodigals, that they're standing, and maybe they are at a crossroads. Maybe God's beginning to stir in some of their hearts. Maybe they're beginning to question a little bit. So they're looking, and they're asking, and they see different ways. Maybe someone tells them, this is the way, or you can do this. And someone's telling them, there's many ways to God. There's all different reasons people get astray. And so we want them to stand at the crossroads, and God brings someone into their life, stir in their heart. He can stir in their heart because many of these people in here were raised in the church, true? And it's in there. The Word of God is in there, and the basic tenets of the faith are in there. So that they would ask for the old paths, God would show it to them, and then what would they do? Walk in it. That we will see them walking on that path. And then we have a promise. If you will stand, if you will look, if you will ask and walk in the way, what's the promise? You'll find rest for your soul. How many of them are seeking all kinds of things because they have a void in their heart that only God can fill? So we want them. My prayer is that they will come to this point. They will be pointed to this, or God will bring up memory verses and hymns that they learned when they were children. They will see it, and they will obediently walk in it, and God promises rest for that soul. He will fill that void that so many of them are seeking to fill with fame and fortune and I don't know what all. So that's our prayer. Will you join me this week? Have you flagged it? And I'll send you an email. We want to pray this prayer, this scripture, for our prodigals every day. Bring them before the Lord that they will be drawn to the old path and that they will walk in it. That's what we want to see this week. What did the children of Israel say? You see the footprints? What did they say? We will not walk in it. That was their response. I pray that will not be the response of any of these that we are burdened for. We want to see them return and walk in these old paths. So the prophet goes on to say, Malachi, now he's the last prophet, remember, of the Old Testament. And he says, remember the law of Moses, my servant, which I commanded to him in Horeb for all of Israel with the statutes and the judgments. Every prophet told him to return to the basics of the faith. And in 2 Chronicles chapter 29 through 31, every revival that came to Israel, every one of them, was the result of returning to the basics and returning to the law of Moses. What does God promise us? If you will preach the word in season and out of season, lift up the name of Jesus Christ, what does he promise? He will draw all men to him. We don't have to have fancy programs. We don't have to have all these things trying to get people to come. He promised us if we would preach the word and exalt Jesus, he would bring the people. So now they've given what they want the people to do. Now they go into divine judgment and warnings because they said, we will not walk in that way. And in Amos 3:1, he says, hear the word that the Lord has spoken against you, O people of Israel, against the whole family that I brought up out of the land of Egypt. You only have I known of all the families of earth. Therefore, I'm going to punish you for all of your iniquities. Now, God chose them, correct? He chose this nation. So did they not feel they had a place of divine favor? Do you remember what they said in the New Testament? We're of Abraham's seed. What about in the Old Testament when they were pronouncing judgment? What did the people that lived in Jerusalem say? God's never going to let them destroy Jerusalem. We have the temple here. Just because you have a place of divine favor, he says you also have a place of divine punishment when you presume upon the divine favor. And you're presumptuous about it and you think, God's not going to punish me. I'm one of his chosen. And that's what they were doing as a nation in Israel. What did he put them through? The kingdom of Judah, Benjamin and Judah. They go 70 years into captivity, don't they? And so that's part of the divine judgment that came upon them. He says, and you and I need to learn, divine election does not abolish human responsibility. We all still have a free will. Now, in the days of Malachi, now this applies to you and me a lot. In the days of Malachi, they are living in open sin. The people are rebelling against God. But what are they saying? We're looking for our Messiah. They're looking for the Messiah. What are they going to do when he comes and finds them like that? We say that we want the Lord to come, right? But are we living so that we will not be ashamed when he comes? They weren't. And boy, we sure don't want to be. And so he goes on to say in Malachi, who can abide the day of his coming? He said, who can endure it? Because when he comes, who can stand there? Because he's going to be like a refiner's fire and fuller's soap. That's what you're facing when he comes. So when you say, I am really looking forward for the rapture, it doesn't make sense to say that unless you're living like you're ready to stand before him. And that's exactly what Malachi was telling them. He said he's going to sit as a refiner and a purifier. He's going to purge them like gold and silver. He said, then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasant to the Lord as in the days of old and as in former years. And he says, but I'm coming in judgment. I'm going to be a swift witness against the sorcerers, adulterers, perjurers, and those who are exploiting wage earners, the widows and the orphans, and against those who turn away an alien or a stranger because they do not fear me, says the Lord God. Now, what are the people saying? Here's the people. What are they saying? Just like the people of today. Oh, you prophets, oh, you seers, we don't want you to see those things. Don't tell us about all those things like that. Don't prophesy to us the right things. Don't tell us these truths and all this judgment and everything that will be upon us. We want you to speak smooth things to us. They even said, we want you to prophesy deceits and prophesy lies to us. Can you imagine? Are we like that today? Our culture is a lot. What do some churches, the people sitting in the congregation, oh, don't tell me about sin. Just call it, what does it say? Oh, call it a bad choice. And then they say, please don't talk about hell. It makes me so uncomfortable. We have easy believism today and people that don't want to hear the truth of God's word. True? Just like they did. They told the prophet, don't tell us those things. So people today still don't want to hear the truth that makes them bear responsibility for their actions. Letter D, the prophets also reassert the inviolability of God's kingdom covenant. What does that mean? It is incapable of being violated, and it is secure from destruction in the future. So through all the bitter prophecies of judgment that were being pronounced against Israel, there's never the slightest intimation that God's covenant with Israel would ever be broken or ultimately fail. So if you hear a teacher or a preacher or read after someone that says God is through with Israel and has no more purpose for them, what do? Shut the book and don't listen, because that is not a biblical view. God still has much to do with Israel. And as you put the Bible together and see that, it becomes abundantly clear. He says in Malachi, he says, I am the Lord God and I change not. He says, so you descendants of Judah are not destroyed. He says, I may punish you, but I will not destroy you. So in Jeremiah, he says, David was the throne of David and the one to sit on the throne of David, the Messiah, the future king promised to David. Yes. And he says, David will never lack a man to sit on the throne of the house of Israel. And in Jeremiah 33, he says, listen, if you can break his covenant with the sun and the moon, remember that's why we have day and night, God's covenant with the sun and the moon and all of the things in the heavens. He said, if you can break that, then my covenant could be broken with the nation of Israel or with David, my servant. But we know that that can happen. So he's saying it will never happen that David will not have a son to reign on his throne. So then the prophets begin to speak of a better future, a better kingdom that's coming. Should this be good news to the people? Yes, but it's way in the future. So we are able to distinguish that as we look at the scripture. He said, it is the glory of God to bring light in the midst of the gross darkness. It was dark, depressing times. Things looked so bad, but then the prophets began to come forth and say, there's a better day coming. This kingdom is going to be reestablished on earth, and Jesus Christ will be the King of Kings. Beyond the night of man's sin, there is always the glorious day that's coming of God's unfailing grace. And we see that as we will begin to study more and more and get into the millennial kingdom. Now let's look at the end. We've gone through the decline. Let's look at the very end of this mediatorial kingdom in Old Testament history. Where did it begin? At Mount Sinai. Y'all with me? It began at Mount Sinai. Was it with supernatural power and glory? Yes, and we have seen that. Now Ezekiel is going to tell us about the end of it. The end of it on earth is coming, and Ezekiel is where we go to find out about it. Had the Shekinah glory been with them since Mount Sinai? Yes, as a nation, they had seen it over and over, the regal significance of it. In Nehemiah, it says, because of your great compassion, you never did abandon them in the wilderness. By day you gave them that pillar of the cloud that did not fail to guide them on their path, and then they had a pillar of fire at night. So God was always leading and directing them since at Mount Sinai. We see them as they cross the Red Sea and going through the wilderness. There's a manifestation always of the Shekinah glory of the Lord in his presence. We saw the fire and the smoke on Mount Sinai. That's a sign of his presence with the people. When they received the laws and the constitutions and they had the marriage contract and they said, we will and we do, they had the sign of his presence there. And then in Exodus it says, Moses went up in the mountain, the cloud covered it, and the glory of the Lord settled on the mountain and enveloped it. He gave them signs of his presence all through their journey. When they finished the tabernacle and every time they took it down and then they set it up, the Shekinah glory was always there. When Solomon dedicated the temple and had the dedicatory prayer, the glory of the Lord filled the temple. So everywhere they went, all through this kingdom, we see the Shekinah glory of God showing them his presence. But now we're going to come to the end. In Ezekiel 8 is where we're going to go. This is what it's like at the end, and here's Ezekiel the prophet, and he's going to tell us what it's like at the end of the kingdom. In Ezekiel 8, verse 17, it says, "Do you see this, son of man? Can you see what's going on?" Where is Ezekiel? Anybody know? He's in Babylon. Remember, they're in captivity. And most of the Jews are over here in Babylon. And that's where Ezekiel is. But God's going to give him a vision of what's going on in Jerusalem at the temple, which is about 900 miles away. There's still some Jews over here, but the bulk of them have been in captivity for many years in Babylon. So God says, "Do you see this, what's going on?" He's in Babylon when God shows him what's going on in the temple in Jerusalem. So is everybody with me? Okay. Now, who's left in Jerusalem after the three? You remember they went over in captivity three different times. So who's left over here in Jerusalem with the temple? The very poorest of the people. The people that the enemy didn't feel like was worth making the trip to take them here. Remember, Daniel was in the first group. We had Ezra, we had Ezekiel, we have all these guys over here. But the very poor are over here, left in Jerusalem. Now, all of the big shots are gone. We have all this land. So what had the people that are left here become like? They are intoxicated with power. This is all theirs now. And that's how it says they were acting. They have all this new power. They have all the new land, all the positions that nobody would ever give them. Who's got it now? We do. So they are intoxicated with power. They've got all this property now, and they have all the positions. And it says they turned their heads. So they became kind of uppity in their position over here. Now, what's happening? False prophets are arising, and what are they telling the people in Jerusalem? They are predicting, you know, you're going to have a speedy restoration from what was lost to Nebuchadnezzar. Remember when Nebuchadnezzar took the first group, Daniel and them, what else did he take? All of the sacred vessels that were in the temple, and they went over here to Babylon. And so Nebuchadnezzar and his men took everything of value. And so what are the prophets telling the poor people? You know, it's going to be a speedy thing, and y'all are going to get everything back that Nebuchadnezzar took. This was in great contradiction to what Jeremiah told them. Jeremiah said, you're going to be in captivity how long? 70 years. And they knew that ahead of time from Jeremiah. So here they are. I'm one of the poor people over here in Jerusalem. And I have a sign out, help. I need some help. And where are they going to get help? Who are they going to? All I have left are the surrounding pagan nations around me. So they don't have any leaders. The prophets are telling them false things. And so they're trying to make alliances with the pagan neighbors. Is that going to help their spiritual condition? No, not at all. So what happens to the people in Jerusalem? They're going deeper and deeper and deeper into idolatry and into paganness, and they're becoming just like their pagan neighbors. So here's what God's going to show Ezekiel in his vision. He said, look out on that north side. Do you see what they have put there in the inner court? And there was an idol. It was a pagan idol, and it was called the image of jealousy, and it provoked God to jealousy. And so Ezekiel sees that. And then in verse 6, God says, son of man, do you see what they're doing in the temple? He said, look at it. He said, Israel is committing great abominations in the temple. Is the temple the presence of God? That was his dwelling place. And just like I've been doing all week working on this lesson, put yourself, I am his dwelling place. Okay? And let it apply to us individually. They are committing great abominations in the temple. And he says, to make me go far away from my sanctuary. Do you see what that says? They're doing these things, and it will make God go away from his sanctuary. But notice this, even in the midst of this existing intolerable situation that they have found themselves in, where is God at this time? His presence is still there in Jerusalem, even with all this stuff we're going to see that they are doing. But he may depart. So let's see what's happening. Israel's dreadful apostasy. We want to look at the evidence. God's called it out. Let's look at the evidence. Do you see that passage where it says God showed Ezekiel a hole in the wall? And he told him to dig in the hall, and there was a door, and Ezekiel then could see right into the temple in Jerusalem that was almost 1,000 miles away. And he said, look at this hole in the wall, and it leads to a secret place. There's 70 of Israel's elders in there, and they're in an attitude of worship. And what are they worshiping? It says they have creature idols, they have creeping things on the floor, and they have abominable beast pictures of them. And it says they have painted these things on the walls of God's temple. And this is an artist's rendition. As Ezekiel looked in, he could see these 70 elders. And can you see things on the wall? They have some of the pagan gods and so forth, and they have creeping things on the floor. That says they all had their incense burners, and the room was filled with smoke, and they are worshiping all of these things in God's temple. Now, God said, okay, Ezekiel, I want you to turn and look out on the north gate, and look at what the Israelite women are doing. They are weeping for Tammuz. Y'all know who Tammuz is? Our study in Babylon, you can go back and review that. He was a heathen god, and in the Greek, he was compared to Adonis. And this was their, quote, Jesus Christ. I want to look at this just a minute. The worship of him became so licentious with its orgies and all the sexual immoralities that were going on, even Constantine suppressed the cult because that's how wicked it was. And the Israelite women are out on the north gate, and they are weeping for Tammuz. Why? This is the paganism that was coming in to the temple with the Israelite women. And you can see that they are weeping and they are mourning. And I'm going to tell you just a brief thing about what is happening here, why they are weeping. In the Greek culture and the pagans that was going on, and this was in Babylon, Tammuz was believed to have been killed by a wild boar. And this is why winter comes every year. This is signifying his death. I'll tell you, they say he was born on December 25th. And so he's been killed by the wild boar, and that's why winter comes. But we will start weeping for him 40 days before the new moon, when spring will come. And so they're weeping for him because they're hoping that he will be resurrected and that spring will come. That is the paganism root of Lent. And that's those 40 days that the pagans would celebrate, weeping for him, because if he's not resurrected, spring won't come. So that is why God was so incensed that the Israelite women were weeping in the temple for Tammuz, because that's what the pagans around them would be doing. And then he said, I want you to look now in the inner court, and there are 25 priests. These are the spiritual leaders, and they have their back turned to the temple. They've got their back away from the temple, and what are they doing? They are facing the east, and they are worshiping the rising sun. That's very pagan, the worshiping of the creation instead of the creator. So this is Israel's priesthood, and these are the things that are going on. I know this ink drawing is a little bit blurry, but it's the only one I could find. But you've got the priest of the nation of Israel left in Jerusalem at the temple. Their backs are turned, and they're worshiping the sun. So these are the three things that God called to Ezekiel's attention of why he was so incensed with the nation of Israel. Now compare that. What were they like in the beginning at Mount Sinai? You remember when you were born again? In the beginning, when you first came to him and you knew he forgave your sins and you had a Savior, how wonderful it was. And I was 8 years old. I want to be the best little Christian girl. I'm going to read my Bible. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this. You remember the beginning? That's how it was at Mount Sinai. They had that attitude of we will and we do. And they all united, all the people together standing at Mount Sinai gave the solemn pledge to Jehovah God. Everything he says, we will do it. Whatever he wants, we will do it. The women, remember when they were going to make the tabernacle in the wilderness, the women were giving freely of their skills to make everything that was needed to prepare Jehovah's dwelling. Do you remember what it's like when you wanted to surrender to him in absolute surrender, and you're willing to do whatever it took to prepare the dwelling place? I'll read my Bible. I'll meditate on the word. I'm going to give some of these things up. I want this to become a holy vessel, a holy place for God to dwell. That's what the women were doing. They did everything they gave of themselves to prepare his physical dwelling. And now what are they doing? The apostasy is involving the entire nation. They were making cakes for the Queen of Heaven, who they say was Mary, and they even had their children involved in it. So it involved all the people, it involved the elders, it involved the women and the priesthood. And in verse 18, God gives the verdict. I'm going to deal with them in my rage, my fury, and in my anger, and I'll show them neither pity nor compassion. They will cry loudly, directly in my ears, and I will not listen. So this is the result of what was going on. And in Ezekiel 21, he says, take off your mitre and you take off your crown. I will overturn it. And this also will never happen until the one who has authority over it arrives, because then I'm going to give it to him. And who is that? Jesus Christ. And that will be the kingdom that's coming after the 7-year tribulation period. So now, this is some of the saddest scripture in all of the Bible. Ezekiel is going to witness the division of the glory of the Lord departing from the temple. In chapter 8, verse 4, it says, the glory of the Lord had been still in Jerusalem. We go in its proper place in the temple. It was still there. And then in chapter 9, it said the glory of the Lord was gone up. And it says it went to the threshold of the house. And then in chapter 10, the glory of the Lord stands over the threshold. And it illuminates the inner court with the brightness of deity. And in Ezekiel 10, the glory of the Lord departs from off the threshold of the house, and it stands over the cherubim. And then in Ezekiel 11, the glory of the Lord leaves from the midst of the city of Jerusalem. It goes to the mountain on the east side of the city, which would be the Mount of Olives, and it departs. The glory of the Lord departed from the temple in that day. I noticed God's gracious departure. Do you see it? It was slow. It was reluctant, like he was yearning to remain. He didn't really want to go. He lingered, hoping that they would repent and that they would turn back to him. This is the place he had chosen for his dwelling place. But he was going to leave it. But there was no evidence of any repentance or entreaty on Israel's part. Oh, you know, I repent. I'm sorry. I want you to clean this vessel. What are they doing? They're bowing to the idols, burning the incense, weeping for Tammuz, and worshiping the sun. And the glory of the Lord departed. God warned them during Hosea's day. In Hosea, he said, I'm going to go back to my place. So where was he going? Heaven. He says, I'm going to go back to my place until they acknowledge their offense and seek my face. And in their affliction, they will seek me earnestly. So the departure of Jehovah, Samuel Andrews says, from his temple and from his land, it marked a change in his theocratic relation. Remember, he had been the God of Israel ruling over them through a mediator. And a change that continues to this day. It's still this way today. Look at the changes. They didn't cease to be his covenant people. His purpose in them is just unfulfilled. I hope that all of us are yielding to him for his purpose to be fulfilled in us, to change us into the image of Jesus Christ. His promises about the Messiah and the kingdom, he never withdrew those promises. He continued to accept their worship. The visible glory, though, no longer was dwelling between the cherubim. The ark was not in the most holy place. The holy fire was no longer burning on the brazen altar. Even though they rebuilt the temple later and they set up worship, there was still a change. After their return, they will never be that independent nation again, headed by him, until they became the nation in 1948. They were never restored to their original standing, the theocratic people under God's immediate rule that will come again during the millennial kingdom. It will not be true until the Lord their God dwells among them and rules through his king. You must believe in a literal kingdom, or much of what the prophet said, it doesn't make any sense. There will be a literal kingdom, and much of the prophecy will be fulfilled. We'll have the house of David. He'll be ruling for the house of David in truth and in righteousness. So what happened next after all this? When the glory of the Lord departed, who's going to take over ruling the world now? The Gentiles. So there's going to be a transfer of power now, and God is the one in charge still, and he's going to give power to the Gentiles. And notice Hosea chapter 3, verse 4. The children of Israel are going to abide many days with no king. They won't have a prince. They won't have a sacrifice. They will not have an image, an ephod, or a teraphim. So they're going to be without their religion, we'll say, for a number of years. It has been 8 centuries since the glory of the Lord appeared at Mount Sinai until this time in history. No nation has ever stood successfully against Israel as long as they would follow their king's divine will. They suffered defeat when they turned their back on the charter of freedom, on the covenant, and they were in rebellion. Then they suffered defeat. But when they repented, what did God do? He was very gracious, and he restored everything to them. Who was their last king in Judah? Zedekiah, thank you. So Zedekiah is the last king, and the cup of Israel's iniquity finally filled up. And God said there's no remedy. And remember, they killed Zedekiah's sons in front of him, poked his eyes out, and took him to Babylon. So we have three things that signal the end of this, and these three things occurred in a period of only 10 years. Number one, God decided to transfer the power and the ruling even of Israel to the Gentile powers. They would now become the powers in the world. And where do we find that? In Nebuchadnezzar's dream and his vision, and Daniel interpreted it. You're going to have the king of Babylon, and then you're going to have Persia, then you're going to have Greece, Rome, and you and I are living in the age of getting close to the 10 toes. And what's going to happen? The kingdom from God, Jesus Christ, the stone kingdom, is going to come and crush all the Gentile kingdoms at that time, and then his king will stand forever and ever. Point number two, the second thing that happened, there was an end to Solomon's family ever reigning on the throne of Israel. Number three, the mediatorial kingdom that God had established at Mount Sinai now has officially terminated in 591 BC when the glory of the Lord left and departed from the temple. Now, the prophets, though, they give us some comfort, and you and I in the next few weeks are going to be looking at a lot of the prophecies about the future. Better days are ahead. Is that not a good thing? That's like having the children having those little teddy bears, right? There's something about teddy bears that's comforting. I don't know what it is. But better days are ahead. God is going to be your refuge during this long period of captivity and dispersion. God, they're still God's chosen people. The scattered Israel will be compensated to some degree by God's presence and his help through centuries of dispersion. Isn't it amazing how he began to gather them back? They were a nation born in a day in May of 1948. And even though they've been dispersed all over the world for a long time, they never lost their language. So God has done some miraculous things to show that he's with them until the kingdom is restored. Now, the outcasts are being regathered in the promised land to worship in a final temple that will be built. Remember, there's going to be a new temple in the millennium. Haggai, in Haggai 2, came to the people, remember, in Nehemiah's day. And he said, you need to get your temple rebuilt. Remember, they laid the foundation, and how long did the foundation sit there? 16 years, and they didn't do any more work. Haggai encouraged them to get busy and get the temple finished. He said, your Mosaic covenant is still good. And he said, the future millennial temple will surpass the glory of Solomon's temple even, or of Herod's. God graciously gave Ezekiel this vision about the future return of the glory of the Lord. So in conclusion, as we wrap all this up about this mediatorial kingdom in the Old Testament, they tell us the glory of Jehovah will return to a Jewish temple in the future kingdom. The kingdom of God is going to be established on this earth. A temple is going to be built in Jerusalem. In Ezekiel 43, he said, here is the place of my throne. And he was speaking about Jerusalem. And I'm going to dwell in the midst of it, how long? Forever. Remember Zechariah 14? When he returns, he says he's going to set his feet on the Mount of Olives. There's going to be a huge earthquake, and it's going to split in two. The north will be pushed one way and the south, and a valley will be made to go to the east and to the west. And it says, the Lord will be king over the entire earth. Can you imagine? You and I have an opportunity to have a part in his kingdom, even though we will be in a glorified body. We find out what our part is at the judgment seat of Christ, where the rewards and all of that will be given out based on our obedience and the way we're living our life now. Why did this mediatorial kingdom in history utterly fail and deteriorate? Many of them will tell you the main reason: lack of spiritual preparation on the part of the people. And that's most of our problems today. When we fail and when we stumble, we're not spiritually prepared. We need to spend time being spiritually prepared. We are the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. Remember, no government can totally succeed. You see all the people? All the people. No government will totally succeed unless there exists among all the people that inward harmony to back their constitution, to back their laws with us, to back the word of God and to believe it. Even in God's kingdom, are we robots? No, we have free will. It says we are not controlled mechanically or externally by some irresistible divine power that just makes us act the way that we do. We're not his robots. The rulers that God used to mediate his laws were not perfect. And number three, any lasting reform in government has to start where? At the top. Just like in our church, we need good leaders leading our churches. So against the darkness of failure, the rulers and the people of this Old Testament kingdom, the prophet said, there's a better day coming. For you and me, it's the same message because it hasn't happened yet. There is still a better day coming and a better age. He says in Jeremiah, he's going to write his law on the hearts of all of the people. In Jeremiah, he says, I'm going to give them a heart to know me, that I am the Lord, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God, for they shall return to me, how? With their whole heart. What did they say in Jeremiah? We will not. But he says, now they're going to return to me with their whole heart. So this mediatorial ruler of this kingdom on earth that's coming is God's messianic king, Jesus Christ. Isaiah 11:1 tells us it's a shoot that's going to come out of the stump of Jesse, and a branch from his roots are going to bear fruit. So the future success of this independence, of this Jewish state, is inseparably bound up with a divine reestablishment of the kingdom by supernatural means. What does that mean? How did he set up the first kingdom? A lot of supernatural signs. He's going to set up this kingdom with a lot of supernatural things as Jesus returns at the end of the 7-year tribulation period. Puts down the enemies. We have a 75-day interval for many things are going to happen to launch the kingdom. It's going to be a glorious time. All military and political attempts that keep going on all over our world to have peace in the Middle East, they're going to fail. All of them are going to fail because Hosea 3:4 says they're going to abide many days without a king. They're not going to have their temple. They're not going to have their sacrifices. They're not going to have anything. But he promises them and gives them hope in Isaiah. He says, say to them that are fearful, a fearful heart, be strong and don't fear. Behold, your God is going to come with vengeance, and he is going to recompense all of those enemies. And then he's going to come and save you. I look forward to that day. Let's pray. Father, we thank you how that you just open the Bible up. And when we get into it and dig, the treasures of the word just exude from the pages. And we just, it's an infinite book of treasure where you show us so many things, and the Old Testament is alive with things that can apply into our lives. And I thank you that the Word of God convicts us, it exhorts us, it encourages us. And most of all, James 1 says, the Word of God implanted in my heart is able to save my soul. What a promise. May we be obedient to get in the Word. Let it come alive in our hearts through the power of the Holy Spirit. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.